It is time now to introduce Allison Ashley Friedlander. She was named 2017 Texas Teacher of the Year. She's currently an instructional coach at Becker Elementary School in Austin, Texas. She has worked for 10 years as a bilingual teacher. She served as grade level leader. She served on campus and district advisory committees. She's mentored candidates pursuing national board certification in our school district and also for Teach for America. She holds degrees from Boston College and the Harvard Graduate School of Education. She is committed to growing new teachers and shaping the profession. And I think you're going to find her to be just a wonderfully inspiring speaker this morning. So I give you Allison Ashley Friedlander, 2017 Texas Teacher of the Year.
This awesome recognition for all of the work that you have done in your classroom. It's really exciting to be here to celebrate this with you. Today I'm going to share with you some stories about my journey as a teacher, as an elementary bilingual teacher, and this journey towards becoming a more vision-driven educator. And I actually find it kind of ironic when I'm talking about becoming vision-driven, because I've had a colossal failure of being vision-driven in my own personal life. This is my new puppy, Ruby. He looks adorable over there, right? I had this vision of getting a puppy and coming home and just cuddling with him and him greeting me at the door and going for walks and his little tail wagging. And that's not the story. You can see he's already taken my spot right at the computer where I'm trying to do work, torn up toilet paper, chewed the posts of our deck in the backyard, taken apart shoes. So that is a personal failure of mine. So I just wanted to start with that. I'm still trying to learn how to be vision driven here. But the weekend before we went, when I picked him up, I ran to the bookstore and got such a mom's book, such a mom's dog was first. I've been trying to channel him in the training that I've been doing with my own dog. But this morning, I would love to take you on a journey with me back to, back through the years and think about students that we've had along the way. So how many of you, I'd just love to see a show of hands in here, how many of you have had a student at some point in your career that has challenged you? Seriously? We've all had students that have challenged us in this profession. Now I'm going to drill down and think about a student over the past 5, 10, 15, maybe even 42 years, like I've been doing here, I've been teaching for, that has actually catalyzed a change in your practice. We're going to share this out in a moment. But for me, I think back to Hope Swipe, I had a number of years ago in my second grade classroom. And he asked me one day, Ms. Ashley, why do we have more English books than Spanish books in our classroom library? This seemingly simple question revealed for me implicit messages that I had been sending students. And it really called into question and revealed this tension that existed between my espoused values of English and Spanish holding equal value in the classroom, and then my actual practices and the resources I had there. And this question stuck with me like static thing does for the rest of the day. I couldn't shake it. It was super annoying. It was a blaring evidence of some of my shortcomings as a teacher. So what did I do? I ran to the school library that day with my portable down the ramp over to the school library and loaded it up with Spanish books. I went to our local library and checked out all the great books I could find and went back to my classroom and put them all into the book bins and tried to really build up this kind of like warehouse to show students that both languages are valuable and not one is better than the other. And we need to have the best books in both languages in my classroom. And I just remember at the end of the year, the checkout list, you guys are all familiar with this, right before you leave for summer vacation, like the one thing between you and summer break is like the checkout list with all the signatures on the edge. I said, you all have in your districts, right? And the stack of library checkouts that I get in my box because I had that many books that I had to return to the library and go back digging through the books to try to find them. I also think about a student like Aaron, who really helped me redefine my expectations of what is possible in the classroom, who really showed me how students can engage one another in conversations and how if I turn the power over to students and trust that in the process, that they could lead incredible conversations and captivate their own little group audiences in ways that I couldn't. And Aaron pushed me to provide more opportunities that were rich and authentic for students in my classroom in a way no professional development experience had. So these are just two examples of how students over the past 10 years in my experience have really pushed me to be better in my practice. So just in the spirit of celebration, we're all here today to celebrate, in the spirit of the one thing that brings us together, students, I would love for you at your tables, I think we all have teaching experience in here, whether we're teachers, principals, superintendents, staff at the faculty at the Weatherford College have had students along the way. So just turn to someone and let's celebrate how these incredible individuals, our kids, have pushed us to be better teachers and better people, and we'll come back in just a few minutes. Great, walking around here with some inspiring anecdotes and some tiny ones as well. So that's awesome. Kids can make us feel all of the emotions, right? So I'm going to just share with you this learning along my journey becoming more vision-driven in the classroom. And that is that in this profession, our students are often our best teachers, right? But their best teachers are often our students. And yes, there is great value in implementing current research and going to professional development and teaming with your colleagues. When we slow down and we listen to our students and really dig for the messages that are in their words, they can have a profound impact on our own growth and development in the classroom. So with that, I want to give a huge thanks to all the students that have helped us become who we are as teachers. And not just them, I want to give a special thanks today to the teams that we work with. We know that in this work of educating and raising up the future of our nation, we cannot do this work alone. We're talking about parents, librarians, counselors, principals, superintendents, faculty at institutes of higher education, counselors. There are so many people that help us do our jobs and do our jobs well. So thank you to all the principals and the faculty here and the superintendents that have helped us. Also, a huge thanks to everyone that makes it possible, right? Oftentimes we talk about the importance of raising the prestige in teaching. I don't know if y'all have breakfast like this in your faculty rooms on Fridays, but we certainly don't. This is great and so awesome to be here with all of you and really celebrating the excellence in your classrooms and elevating teaching as a profession. There's great work to be done there, and I think this is a great example of that. And finally, thanks to all of you. An incredible work. I read through your biographies. I think your little bios are in the packet before coming here. And there's incredible work being done. I read about Mr. Richmond. Is Mr. Richmond here? Yes, no? Well, Mr. Richmond? Connected the students through the love of literature and has inspired many students to become English teachers as well. Randy Garden. Well, he's been noted as the first to arrive and the last to leave at the end of the school day, and he engages his kids in mathematics through UIL and other sort of curricular activities. And then Debbie Hartzell? Yes, I thought I recognized. I saw you in the program. It's like celebrity spotting. She's over there. A junior high special education teacher who's been teaching for 42 years. That's incredible. Not only 42 years in the same district, but not only that, 42 years in the same school. Think about the transformational impact that she is having on students' lives and an entire community. So thanks to all of you on the incredible things that I know here today in the classroom. At this point, I'd love to take you on a journey with me back to my first year of teaching, the legendary first year. Now, there's a lot that I don't remember, and probably intentionally because I tried to block it out of my memory. But first year is tough. Here I am in my class of first graders down in Brownsville, Texas in 2004. There is so much that I have forgotten about that year, but certain images that I can't shake. Like one morning, I kid you not, I woke up on top of my Scott Forsman reading teacher's edition, and that little spiral had imprinted across my face. I don't know if there's a more humbling message that the universe could send me to remind me that I was a novice teacher. I literally got up and was like driving to school with a spiral in my face. These recurring dreams that I'd have, and I'd wake up in the dream, like in the dream I was in my classroom on my bed, and I'd wake up with 20 kids like staring at me. And I was like, oh, I don't know what to do. Kids just keep working, and in the dream I go back to sleep, right? All of this to say that there was like no separation between personal and professional life. Teaching is what I, you know, breathe, slept, ate. I was just trying so hard to get better. People would come into my classroom and say, you know, another picture I was going to put up here, but I just couldn't do it. It was like this picture of my classroom and the little kids sitting in rows. It was so bad, right? I was trying to do my best, but like, I just, you know, I was trying to make this transformational change with my students, but they were all sitting in rows, and someone told me I should try centers, and that sounded awesome, right? Like, in theory, kids learning in groups and collaborating and cooperating, and in my mind, I just wasn't ready to, like, relinquish and let go of the little bit of control that I worked so hard to get with my students. Or the time that one of my students was crying for me, I went up to her and I said, Nicole, what's wrong, sweetie? She goes, well, I'm trying to read this book, but I don't know how to read. And literally, hours later, I was like fumbling through a phonics lesson, trying to make up all these sounds, and I just felt ill-equipped and underprepared. Teaching reading is hard. Do I have any lower elementary teachers here at UC people? Phonics is hard, yes. Like, struggling through the sounds and trying to figure out how to teach them. But through this all, something kept me going. And that is having experienced firsthand the life-changing impact a teacher can have in the classroom. And that's through my mom. My mom spent her entire career as a bilingual elementary school in Boston, Massachusetts, where we grew up. She, after moving to the States from Argentina, got certified to teach bilingual education and worked in a school. And I just remember growing up, all the phone calls, like daily, multiple kids calling home. One kid was excited about this documentary or show that he saw on sharks on the TV and wanted to tell my mom everything that he was learning because they were learning about sharks in class. Or the time that kids would like fight over her single copy of Pinocchio that she had in the classroom and then call her so the kids and their siblings could read the book out loud over the phone to her, right? This is evidence that kids love learning. Not for stickers, not for report card grades, not because she was like bribing them with candy. They love learning for what it was because my mom was able to inspire them and influence them through all of these engaging lessons. Now, what I didn't mention about the Madison School in Boston is that it's a wonderful community and lots of great things and hardworking teachers are there trying to do the very best that they can with their students. But if you were to look in the local newspaper, you'd find some pretty troubling stories about the school and how it's been underperforming for a number of years, despite huge efforts by district leaders, principals, teachers to turn the school around. My mom never saw that as an excuse. She never saw the challenges that the teachers face, the lack of resources as a way of standing between what was possible. This school, I remember one year I went to visit, and it was a beautiful building. There's actually a bridge and a swimming pool over on this part of the building for elementary schools for people that had been shut down. The central artery of the school was a two-story library with these staircases and all these nooks and crannies for kids to go into and read. But sadly, that library had been closed a number of years ago. It's like, oh my goodness, all of these books. But because of whatever reason in the system, they were not available to students. And my mom didn't let that stand in her way. And a lot of the students lived in subsidized housing, and she'd make home visits and built relationships with families and really engaged them. And I reached out to her, not just for guidance with their students, but on life advice, right? She was having a profound impact and had an unbelievable ability to connect with these students. So she was one of the main reasons that I wanted to teach. And I knew that entering the classroom, I knew that all kids had the potential to achieve at grade levels, regardless of their socioeconomic status, the zip code, the neighborhood they grew up in, the color of their skin, their linguistic profile, or any other identifying marker. All of our students are capable of greatness, and that's what my mom saw. And she was able to create with them lasting change. She helped some of these students get into some of the most prestigious programs in the Boston area, some of the best schools. And it was no surprise a number of years ago when a student called her and asked her for advice on his academic track at Brown University. He was pursuing a master's degree and was unsure which way to go. And what did he do? He called one of his teachers. Not just any teacher, like she probably taught him, she's between second and third grade, like an elementary school teacher, right? We all have to, because she kept these relationships going for years after they had left her class. So in that first year of teaching, she really, knowing what is possible, really kept me going. And this is another lesson I learned along the way. The first one, you know, that I shared with you is students can be our best teachers. And then this other one of really developing and revisiting your why when times get tough. Teaching is so hard. When you dig down and think about what brought you into this profession or why you're doing what you do, that can be a source of inspiration and a source of energy on the toughest days, right? And so like we did before, oftentimes we don't have the opportunity to sit around and chat with each other about why we're in this work. Why do we do what we do? I know you all have a strong why that brings you here. There's no way that you'd be getting recognitions for all the amazing things that you do with kids unless you had a deep kind of like inspiration and motivation that is guiding you along the way. So I'd love for you guys to share at the tables. We can start with the teachers, then hear from principals and superintendents also. Why do you do what you do? Oftentimes, the why that brings us in is the why that we stay, and sometimes it changes, right? Sometimes why you went to a profession isn't the reason you stay a number of years later. So I'd love to turn it over to you guys for a few minutes and talk to each other about why you do the work that you do. So along this journey to become more vision-driven, a couple of my lessons. Listen to students, they're some of our best teachers, and always go back to your why. And keep developing and revisiting that. Again, it can be a source of inspiration and energy when things get tough. But in life, sometimes having this like lofty idea doesn't necessarily translate to action. Right, so back to my first year of teaching. I knew why I was there. I knew kind of what I wanted to accomplish. But I had absolutely no idea how to get there, right? I was working as hard as I could, but things were just not progressing the way I wanted them to. So I knew my why, and I was thinking, now what? That first era of my teaching, I just think about the spiral, right? By the era of the spiraling notebooks, literally falling asleep on top of teaching positions in day-to-day survival mode. You know, it's Monday, I don't know what I'm teaching Friday, it's Monday morning, maybe I don't know what I'm teaching Monday afternoon, just trying to figure it out as best I could. And I can't tell you the number of times that first year of teaching, maybe this sounds familiar to you guys when you're putting off a task that you know you need to do. I probably rearranged my classroom furniture like once a month. I'm not kidding. I like moved the desk, moved my desk, I changed all the configurations, how kids were sitting, my bulletin boards. I'm not even a creative person. Like, I change my bulletin boards all the time. Why? Because it was something concrete and it looked like success. Like, hey, I want to do this one thing. I'm like, I bet I'm accomplishing it. I'm doing something. Right? I'm having some sort of impact in my classroom. But I still wasn't making progress in terms of like knowing really what my students needed to learn. So what I did one weekend is I hit pause on all of this furniture reconfiguration and day-to-day planning, and I did the work that I knew that I had to do, that I've heard great teachers doing. And I sat down with, I'm sure I'll get some interesting reactions here, I sat down with the teaks, right? I went back to my standards. My parents are making the triggers here in the room. But I went back to the standards, and I was like, I need to figure out what my kids need to learn, right? Like, I kind of knew day to day, I was like going through the teacher's editions and the plans that I had in my district. And I'd heard about some teachers who would get color-coded post-it notes, right? And they'd write the teaks on them and write all the different domains and post them up on posters and look for connections. And I was like, this is what I'm gonna do to help me internalize what my kids need to learn, right? Because like on Monday at short letter A, I don't know what sound is the next in my instruction. Over the course of this weekend, I sorted through the teaks, I looked for connections, I saw how, even in elementary school, like in social studies, you teach economics, right? There's always an economics trend. How does that connect to what we're trying to do in math? Or where are there overlaps between the math and the sciences, or social studies and reading? Like, the critical thinking that they should be doing in reading, how does that connect to the social studies skills the state wants us to teach, even at the elementary level? And this really helped me clarify where I was going with my students. And I kind of saw this as the floor, right? This is the baseline. It's not the ceiling. What I need to do as a teacher is get my kids to a destination, but we can go beyond that destination. It doesn't need to end there, right? So I often talk about these like teaks as the floor and not as the blue line would indicate up here, the ceiling. So after this weekend, like if you had walked into my bedroom, I was with a couple of roommates at the time, I probably looked like some conspiracy theorist or something, because I had all these posters up on the wall that were color-coded, things crossed out, arrows drawn elsewhere. But it was really helpful along that journey of trying to figure out what to teach my kids. And I brought with me a little artifact. You guys might think this is a little bit silly. But after all that work had been done, I created this sheet that was like an added glance reference page. And I've kept it in my, I've moved classrooms a gajillion times. And I just can't throw this piece of paper away because it reminds, and I'm not like a scrapbooker. I lived in 400 square feet for the past 5 years of my life. Like, I don't own that much, and I couldn't throw this piece of paper away because it's just a reminder of all of that work that I did in trying to sort through my curriculum. And it's nothing fancy, but this was my added glance. Like, I had synthesized the teaks, I had color-coded them, I had put them on notebooks, on a piece of notebook paper, and here was my synthesis of it all. My listening and speaking teaks, my reading teaks, my writing teaks, so on and so forth. And this was like my added glance. I kept this at the front of my lesson planning notebook, and I'd go back and reference it. It was just like a good reference point as I was planning my lessons, and a good, all these years later, a reminder of all the hard work that goes into that, trying to figure out what to teach students. So every year, when I downsize and clear out the faculty cabinet, that's a sheet of paper I can't let go of, because it reminds me of how important that work is. And this morning, I had the pleasure of sitting over here and speaking with some folks that work at Weatherford. And is it Dr. Ine? Dr. Ine, yes. I was like, you know, I tried to pass off the microphone to him. He's so, a very wise man. Lots of great things to say about education. I tried to pass on the microphone and tell him you can take my spot here. But he talked about the importance of like knowing the student first and making sure that we know who we're teaching. Like, lots of teachers approach this work, if I'm paraphrasing correctly, they approach us like, what content are we teaching? But what he really made me think in that moment was like, yeah, it's important to know who we are teaching. And that is so critically important. And so I had done all this important work of trying to figure out what I was teaching, the destination I was taking things to, but I had to, you know, fast forward a couple years and I tell you a story about one of my students, Thomas, who came into my classroom. And Thomas was a student that people just knew in my school building, right? You probably all have encountered a student like this. I saw his name on the roster and I thought, okay, immediately, like, I didn't have my work cut out for me here. He's a student that I heard teachers talk about in the teacher's lounge. I remember the previous year, his name, he called on the loudspeaker all afternoon as a team of adults ran around the building in our school grounds looking for him. I knew that my work was going to be cut out for me. He entered my classroom and I thought, okay, I'm going to do everything I can to build a relationship with this student. But frankly, he had very little interest in what I had to say. He actually had a lot of interest, but none of them had to do with what I had to say or what I thought we were going to be doing that day. And what I started to realize as I peeled back the layers of this onion is that Tomas also actually had like a pretty negative self-perception. He had kind of accepted the labels that teachers had put on him. And I'm sure that we all see this all too often with our students. It's also a little bit tempting as teachers to accept the label that comes with students, right? Not motivated, troublemaker, doesn't pay attention at school, parents are not engaged. We hear those narratives written and told about our students, and sometimes it's tempting to accept what comes with that. And what I realized about Thomas is that, and this is an invented name that I'm using for him, so I sometimes I pause before I say it, make sure you get the right one, that he had started to accept some of those, that self-identity. And my work was going to be to help him break down that stigma that he had been carrying around. See, I deeply believe that all students care about learning. They all want to feel successful. They all want to be connected with others. And when they seem disengaged in class, it's because of something. So those first couple weeks when he would take balls of paper and ball them up and throw them on the floor, I knew something else was going on. And so this approach I took to planning for academics is an approach that then I applied to classroom culture building. And I started to think through with the same intentionality that I thought about this, what does that student need, right? Because if we think just about the content, we're not going to reach that student. I could have had the most, you know, this is not why we come to teaching, right? Of like this dream of aligning standards on post-it notes. That's not what fires us up as teachers. But I knew that I was going to have to connect with him. So with the same intentionality, I outlined, like, what are we going to do in morning meetings? How is he going to be a part of that? At what points can I eat lunch with him? What other students am I going to bring into my classroom at lunchtime so we can all connect and start to build a community? When things don't go the way that I've planned, how am I going to respond? When he offends another student, How are we going to resolve those issues? Coming up with a plan for that. And also thinking through in my class, you know, at that point I was teaching fourth grade language arts and social studies. I want him to learn his history. I want him to be engaged. He's not going to be engaged reading this out of a book. Like, he is going to be the number one actor when we act out critical points of Texas history. He's going to be the one on stage with this little sentence of, you know, sentence stem hat, acting out the key parts of history that I want him to internalize. I have to get him to see how he can use his writing as a way to communicate his unique ideas, his awesome sense of humor. He had things that kids wanted to hear, and his voice needed to be heard. And I wanted him to feel confident and inspired that his voice did matter. And I tell him all the time too, how cool is this? You've actually got double the audience because you can communicate your ideas in both English and Spanish. And how cool is that? So over time, I started to see some changes with Tomas. I saw that he was more engaged in school. He started to kind of drop that stigma. He started to behave better. He was more engaged. He was, you know, my right-hand man, leader in class. And building relationships with students, I reached out often to his families to get their input and also see to his family to get their input and see how is he doing at home? What changes are you noticing? And little by little, he was more engaged in class. Towards that end of the year, I saw huge changes. We had Saturday writing academies for students that really loved writing, and they would come in, and some of the highest performing students, and it was open to all, and if they wanted to come, they could. And Tomas was like, I want to be there on Saturday, so he gave up soccer to come and be part of that, and just loved connecting with other students over the work that they were doing in writing. And, you know, he had started the year, what I didn't mention was, he had started the year significantly below grade level and was a student that, you know, struggled with academics and also interpersonal relationships. And at the end of the year, he had passed all of his standardized tests. He was, you know, at the school, not many students received advanced ratings on STAR and writing, and in that year he had done that, which was a huge accomplishment and a testament to all of the work that he had done to kind of shed that stigma and shed that reputation that he brought in and really set himself on a new path. But I brought one more artifact in here. What was even more touching for me and I think more important was this little sheet of paper, blocking his actual name at the top here, that he had written just hurriedly at the end of one day and left on my desk. And it reads, "You're the best because you help me in respecting others, in reading, writing, and in all things, so that equals you are a superhero." And why I've kept this over the years is because for me it's a really good reminder that yes, while aligning standards is really important, helping students learn how to and feel motivated to respect one another is so important. We need that first. And this wasn't a writing prompt or a thing I asked him to do, but it was something that he realized. And I love hearing that he called out respect before any of the academics. And that is so, so important in our work. That was supposed to be Tomas up there. I forgot to put that slide up. So if you're wondering what you're doing, there he is. Rather slender guy. So, you know, this brings me to another learning. And I don't know to whom I should credit this little math equation up there, but here's an idea that has stuck with me for many years. And the idea is that outcomes are the product, not the sum, the product of both skill and will. So, you know, still we can think about the seats and the work that I did with all those post-it notes and aligning the standards. Those skills are important for Tomas to be able to communicate his ideas in effective and engaging ways to audiences. He needs to know how to do that as a writer, right? For him to be able to think critically, to analyze sources, to work with primary documents, he needs all of those skills. And it's important that we plan for those. But we also need to inspire and influence and motivate our students. And all you math teachers up there can correct me if I'm wrong, but if either side of this multiplication sign is a zero, our outcome is zero, is that correct? Yes? Yes? Okay, so a little commentary, my God, I'm going to go back and study my skills. And so we just need to always keep that in mind. And sometimes it's easy, I'm sure you've heard this and potentially even felt it. Like, sometimes when students come into our class, not really motivated, but this will side a little bit closer to zero, sometimes it's easy for us to say, like, oh, he's not motivated. Like, challenging learner, not motivated, not bringing his homework, just doesn't want to learn, right? Any show of hands, people that have heard that from anyone? Sadly, right? It's unfortunate. And I think it's a danger of which we need to be aware as educators, that part is as much of our work as the skill building and knowledge building. That is our responsibility. That's why we do what we do. If a student comes in seemingly disinterested, or seems unengaged, or apathetic, or not motivated, it's up to us to figure out how to motivate that student, how to connect with them, how to make our content come to life. And I think back to my mom, the unbelievable ability she was to motivate students. Again, not for stickers, not to move a clip up a behavior chart, not for a report card, but to get kids to love learning for what it is. And if we're not working on both ends, we're not going to achieve the outcomes that we want to with students. So in a nutshell, knowledge and skills matter in our work, but will matters too. So I'd love to pause there and give you all, again, a chance to connect at your tables, thinking about a way that you have worked with students in the past to motivate them or inspire them or influence them to a certain outcome. I shared a couple of the things that I had done with this student over time, and I know everyone in the room has a story that they could share. Maybe one isolated way, like one thing that you did at one particular day, or maybe it's something, you know, in August when you're going back to school and thinking about how you're going to set up your classroom. Maybe it's like a structure that you added or kind of an approach that you're taking to try to help build that motivation, really getting to that intrinsic motivation with students and motivate them to want to learn. And I thought this would be, we have so many powerhouse educators in here, such a great opportunity for us to just learn a little bit from each other. How do we motivate our students? So take a few minutes, and if you're at the university level, I'm sure you can share too, if you have students in your class, what you do to motivate and inspire them. So walking around, literally the first two words I heard at two different tables when I was walking by was relationships. And that is so key. Like knowing our students and knowing how to connect with them. I floated over to this table and I heard this teacher over here in the pink sweater, I think the word you used was approachability. Making sure that students feel safe and know that they can come to us. So much of the work that we do that we're charged with is building relationships with students. And that is foundational to everything we do. Say you all will be receiving copies of, like, over this. You're going to get a book, and you're going to get a book. By Rick Esquith, and it's called Teach Like Your Hair's on Fire, The Methods and Madness Inside Room 56. And those of you that are familiar with Ray, he was a teacher in Los Angeles Unified School District, and did amazing things with his fifth grade students. Rock and roll, Shakespeare, unbelievable work that he has done, and nationally acclaimed teacher. He also, in his book, talked, I'll talk about that piece in this a little bit, but it's an awesome book, and I think it really gets to the root of how we build that inspiration and motivation with students. So I encourage all of you to read that book. I've kind of talked with you through these two eras, starting the spiral teacher's edition, planted on my face era, post an era, getting my standards aligned, and then being as intentional with building a culture and climate in my classroom that I was with academics, and all the planning that goes into that. But still, there are certain things that I feel like I wasn't doing well enough as a teacher. The more I learned, and I don't know if you guys ever feel the same way, but it's like the more I learned about teaching, the more I realized like I needed to be doing even more. Like the more I did, the worse I felt at teaching. And over the years, hearing about STEAM education, all the potential that's there for students, for them to be engineers, to go through a design process, to constantly revise and improve their work, to come up with a better product, and how we could integrate something like the arts with engineering and math and science and technology. Like, I wasn't doing that well. I don't think I was doing it at all. A number of years ago, I learned about social justice standards. I'm not sure if any of you are familiar with them, but Teaching Tolerance has a curriculum called Perspectives for a Diverse America. And there are some standards in for early childhood through high school, and there are four domains: identity, diversity, justice, and action. And the idea is that all of our students need to build a strong identity and feel pride in who they are and what makes them who they are, and also respect the identity of others, to see the beauty that exists in the diversity in our communities and classrooms. The next, you know, identity, justice, the next one is, identity, diversity, the next one is justice. That students can identify what injustice is happening now and in history. And not just identify injustice and be able to create a vision for what a more just society looks like, but actually be able to take action. That's the fourth standard. How can we teach our students to be upstanders and equip them with the skills to stand up in instances of injustice? Was I doing this as a teacher? Not really. I worked in a school that moved from a late exit bilingual program to dual language immersion. Was I doing everything that I could for students to build pride in their background and the languages that they bring into my classroom, where they felt powerful and proud to have these two languages, and they wanted to continue speaking them both? Was I doing that the very best I could? Was I doing that the most effectively I could? Not quite sure. And then a number of years ago, I learned about things like academic parent-teacher teams from the Flamboyant Foundation. The idea that just as schools have PTAs, teachers can have teams in their classrooms with families and engage them in goal setting. So it's not just the teacher's goals and here are all the things that I want to do with the kids, but what are the community's goals and what do parents want for their students' education? And so I was continuing along this journey of being vision-driven, and I was making progress. I wasn't falling asleep on top of teachers' additions anymore. I was more intentional about my planning, but still I felt like there was so much more work that I could do. And at the end of the day, here I am. That's obviously not me, but you can pretend it's me. I was like sitting around waiting for those phone calls, thinking about my mom. Like all the kids would call home just like dying to share about what they were learning at home and connections they were making, and were just like obsessed with the learning environment. And there I was, my phone wasn't ringing. What kind of impact was I having on kids? A few years ago, I've worked for Teach for America I've worked for them for about a decade at their Summer Training Institute, and it's part of what I love about going back every summer and go to Philadelphia for about 2 months and work at this program that trains 800 teachers to work in low-income areas across the country. And a few years ago, Teach for America had developed this idea of a classroom vision, and the idea was that teachers would sit down and really think about, just like CEOs do, or entrepreneurs do, or people in big, you know, positions where they make lots of decisions and set visions for companies, that teachers should be doing the same thing in their classrooms. And there I learned about how to write this vision. So, I don't know if this has a laser pointer on it, but you know, academic achievement. What is it? What's most important for kids to learn in our courses? So that's probably the area where I felt like most okay, right? But then this whole other domain over here, long-term traits and mindsets. Like, what are we doing with our kids? Not just so they comply and do what we tell them to do when we ask, but as teachers, how can we develop these lasting traits and mindsets that will persist years beyond our classroom, right? What types of study skills? How do we want them to see themselves? How are they going to interact with others and engage meaningfully in our society? And then this piece over here, where I know I wasn't doing enough, pathways to opportunity. As teachers, how are we connecting with others in our buildings and outside of our buildings in the broader community to connect kids with awesome opportunities, be them extracurricular activities, summer camps, community programs, writing contests, different experiences that they could have, helping them apply to magnet schools if they want to be, that are really going to set them on a path to achieve great things. That's an area that I knew I had a lot of work to do. And you know, when I read and see Rafe Eswith, the author of this book, I've seen him speak and watch clips of his classroom and in his book, you read it and you're like, this is a vision-driven teacher. This is a teacher that has a very clear sense
of where he is going with all of this, right?
Maybe not so much. And there's another educator, Clint Smith, I'm not sure if any of you have seen this, and he is an English teacher, and we're going to watch a clip in just a moment of him talking about the danger of silence. And as you listen to this, I want you to think, like, does this guy have a vision? And what is that vision that he has for his students? So. Very inspirational speaker, and who in here would love to be in Clint Smith's classroom? I would for sure. And for me, watching him speak about the power of the danger of silence and the power of students' voice makes me realize how clear this man's vision is for the learning of the classroom. He said that he had four things posted on the wall: to read critically, to write consciously, to speak clearly, and to tell your truth. And I'm sure that he did not get those from a set of state standards, right? He probably didn't get those from a paper or a memo or something that he just picked up along the way. For me, this speaks to the importance of really thinking about what do we want our kids in our classroom to accomplish. So meeting teachers like that and this training about me writing a vision and sitting down and doing that at the beginning of the year catalyzed a change in me. And what I did a number of years ago is I sat down, and I'm going to show you a couple of screenshots of my work. It might be a little bit overwhelming, but what the work that I did, sitting down and actually trying to write out a narrative, and I found it so empowering. For so many years, I've been told, day in and day out, what I needed to be doing as a teacher. I felt so reactive to all the asks and demands on my time. When I sat down this one summer to start writing that, it was incredible. I was able to synthesize all of that information that I got and come up with a really clear goal and kind of a place I wanted to go with my students. And so that's basically what I did. I went from the spiral era in my teaching to the post-its and aligning standards to really thinking through a vision, and not just where do I want them to be at the end of the year, but how am I actually going to get there? Just kind of like a blueprint, right? An architect doesn't just say, let's like put up the house, I want it to look like this more or less, and then just like send a team out. We have to be intentional with the plans that we come up with. So I sat down and I started writing this class overview. This actually might be the first time I'm showing it to people up like this, so hopefully they'll be a kind audience to me. But this wasn't something I needed to turn in, but it's something that I knew that I needed to do to be the teacher I wanted to be. So I put into my class overview things like identity, diversity, justice, action, bilingualism, points of personal pride. From some work that our district was doing around technology, I started to think about this idea of the process of learning and what I wanted that to look like. And I pulled out these words from our district vision that then I put into my own learning and what it was going to look like in my classroom. I wanted learning to be active, collaborative, constructive, authentic. I wanted to be goal-oriented for students. And then I did things like this. We talked about the importance, Dr. Ebay, right? Connect with your students first and build those relationships. And how critical I knew that will was in the classroom climate and culture. It's not all about academics. And again, this wasn't asked to be turned in, and it's not a behavior management plan. And this is my own flowchart of my thinking of how I wanted students to build habits that would help them be successful in life. And I did some work reading the Yale Center for Emotional Intelligence. Mark Brackett, there, some of you all think his name, does all this work around feelings and being feelings-driven. What feelings did I want students to have in the classroom? And from there, how, you know, work that we can do for them to envision their best self? What values did we want to have in our classroom? And then what habits did we need to operate with in our class to be successful? And I really wanted to, in this book, Ray Estwood talks about Kohlberg's six stages of moral development. And I was thinking about how can I get students to really identify what is important to them and how they want to be gaining? What's going to set them up for success? What is our code in the classroom? And then what is their personal code? How do they define right and wrong? And it was that intentionality that I took to planning out these ideas of personal development. And then, again, parent-teacher teams is an area that I wanted to grow in, and I wanted to hear from parents what goals and aspirations they had for their kids, because I am part of a community, right? It's not just me alone saying, like, this is everything that I'm going to teach you, and this is it, right? Like, this is what the state tells me. No, I truly believe that we are a community and we need to be bringing parents into these conversations. So I took the same intentionality to think about what types of meetings, right? Like a blueprint. I'm going to have meetings throughout the year with parents. I'm going to reach out to some community partners and engage them in that work. What are my parent-teacher-student conferences going to look like? How am I going to engage students in reflecting on their progress? And then taking a time to look at, this is just an example, some math tips and prioritizing them. I did this for every subject. Like, what did I think was most important given our context, given where students were? And then also, you know, I put them into different tiers depending on needs that I had in my professional development, things that I needed to get better in. So all of this work was really helpful. From there, I was able to integrate parts of, you know, STEAM, social justice, dual language, parent-teacher teams. Here's an example of some of the work my students were doing around. Their goal was to make these, this was around Halloween at some point, these styrofoam hens. Their goal was to get them to move across the floor and to design. I hadn't taught them about circuits or I hadn't shown them how to do this, but I gave them materials and their job was to make these little walking heads move, but later they would decorate them. And they had motors, they had the wires, the battery, lights, and they would design and learn from each other. And here's an example of one student sharing the work that she was doing, and the students would run back to their little projects, and at the end we had a little competition there. Just one example of how it's integrating. Yeah, it's awesome. Their competition, with all the kids would put their little heads on the floor and watch them cruise around. I thought it was hilarious. And social justice standards. Here I have one of my students working on a 3D model, a representation of his identity at the beginning of the year. And he had to interview his family members and work to develop an idea of who is he as a person and represent that artistically in a 3D model. And then they did research on countries of origin and countries that were important to them, and families brought food, and we had a giant potluck, and community members came too, and adults and students interviewed each other to help understand the identities that we had in our classroom, shared identities in some cases, differences, what we valued in each other, and have them make these connections across groups, across age levels, in our school building and beyond. With this vision then, some of these are from different years of teaching. You can probably know the different classrooms here. Here's one year when I taught third grade here. One student whose native language is English and was learning Spanish. And he had wrote about, and he had done a project on Benjamin Franklin, Un Mentor, it says there. And he's got this friend up there who's going to help him with Spanish when he might struggle with a word. But he was getting up there doing the best he could to do the education in Spanish. And over there, we've got some of my students in the past that had put up a little market, and they're selling muñecos de palitos. And you can see on the left that there's a part in English, and on the right the part in Spanish. And how cool is that my kids are becoming salespeople? And all the people, that's a cool salespeople. And down here, a student who had a difficult time summarizing one of the stories, and we worked on creating 3D representations of that to engage them along the way. And here's a picture of some of those parent-teacher team meetings I had where parents would come in and do work with kids, and we'd have food, and we'd talk about goals, and we'd share activities for what we could do at home and at school to reach those goals. So, you know, this has been a journey, and it's not, I'm definitely not done, but this is another lesson that I've learned along the way, is that we need to write a vision, like sit down and do it as a teacher. This is so helpful. And create a blueprint of how we're going to get there. Really outline what's important and really clarify that destination that we're trying to get to with our students. So we're going to wrap up in just a little bit, but all of us here have something that we know is important that we want to accomplish with our kids. Maybe we don't have a clear vision and this is the process. What is something that is critical to you in your classroom that if you were to go home and write a vision today, what would be part of that? And I'm sure principals and superintendents, you're tasked with doing this work probably, so you probably got this pretty well articulated in your mind for your school building or the system in which you work. But teachers, I'd love for you to think, what is something that you would love to include in there? Something that you want students to accomplish, something that you want them to do that's inspirational and something that you can work towards in the next year. So teachers, I'd love for you to share out at your tables, and then if you have time, if other members would share out too. What is part of your vision right now? And I think about this vision is not static, and this vision evolves. It's a destination that we're headed to, but You know, every year it takes work to go back and think about why we're here, what we're trying to accomplish. Every class that we teach is different. It's never the same. And that's part of the work. Every year I write a vision in the summer, and then I go back once I meet my class and I modify it based on what I've learned about the students and try to be responsive to the context in which I'm working and not make it a one-size-fits-all approach. So this is a staircase here to represent that I'm always never done. The day that I'm like done modifying what I'm doing or learning or growing or just have something that's going to work for everyone is the day that I need to get out of this field. And so I encourage you all as we continue moving forward to have that vision and continue communicating it to people. And lastly, just to wrap up, I would love to have a little ask for you guys. And that is, you all are have this recognition of being a Jack Harvey Fellow, which is unbelievable, and congratulations, because it's a really big deal and a testament to your hard work and the success that you've had with your students in the classroom. But having this award doesn't mean, I assume, that you have to be the perfect teacher. But moving forward, I would love for you all to help demystify teaching for your colleagues. I think that is something that we can do to raise the prestige of our profession. None of us were born teachers, we become teachers. It's a learned practice. Just like neurosurgeons are not born neurosurgeons, right? They become through study and through practice, through application of what they're learning. And I heard our commissioner speak last year, and he shared that analogy with us. So, you know, neurosurgeons are involved in complex work. They have all of this knowledge that they're applying, they're having a patient on the table, they're using all these different tools to try to go in and fix a problem. None of that work is easy. And then he mentioned that us teachers are working with like 20 or 30 live brains in one classroom. Like, have you guys ever tried to explain the work that you do to a new educator? Try to explain differentiation. Try to explain to them what you do in a data meeting when you've got ranges of achievement like this, and then all the personalities and dispositions and issues at the classroom. It is so complex. Our work is so hard, right? And we are not born with the skill set to do incredible things with our kids. We learn that. So as leaders in the profession, I ask that you all continue to move forward and demystify what teaching is. Help others in your buildings become better at what they do by sharing your best practices, by sharing your stories with them. Now time's moving forward, now that you have this recognition, and I'm sure like over the years you've been identified just as an awesome teacher on your campus. You might feel sometimes that you need to be like the expert on everything there ever was to know about teaching and the history of time. But as teachers, we don't always have the answers, right? One of the first lessons I shared with you is that students are often our best teachers. There's so much more that we have to learn as teachers. So share with your colleagues not just your successes, but be vulnerable and share your failures. Share where you're struggling. If we're not having those conversations about what is difficult, we're not going to come up with great solutions. So as teachers, we need to be talking to our administrators, we need to be talking to our district leaders, we need to be talking to politicians about what's going well, elevating those stories, but also sharing with them the challenges. So that is, again, another image I forgot to put there. Your work, you're in trouble as a teacher leader. And I'm going to ask that we all, myself included, oftentimes we get invites to sit at the proverbial table, the decision-making table. We know that so many decisions are made that affect our practice and our kids in the classroom at lots of different levels. Leadership in our school, leadership in our district, leadership in the state, right? Federal decisions that are made that affect the work that we do daily and in classrooms. So respond to the invite when it comes, and if there's no invite for your voice to be heard, I will challenge you all, and I try to challenge you myself, to create a seat at that table. And when we're at that table, I think it's really important as teachers and as practitioners that we listen, that we learn, and that we ask the right questions. We don't have all the answers, but we've got powerful stories that we can tell about the work that's being done in our classroom. The better we understand the education system, the better recommendations we'll have, the better policy solutions we'll be able to provide, and the better change we'll be able to make. So when you're at that table, ask questions, learn, listen, But don't forget to elevate your voice and the voice of your colleagues. People need to hear from us and from the work that's happening in the classrooms day in and day out. So moving forward, I hope all of us in the room will continue to do that, to elevate our voice, to elevate student voice, to share our stories, so we can ensure all kids in this country, all kids in our state, all kids in our districts, in our classrooms, are getting an excellent education, regardless of, as I said before, their home language, their nationality, their zip code that they grow up in, the neighborhood that they live in. All kids deserve a great education, and I'm asking that we all move forward as teacher leaders and help advocate for that. So thank you very much. Congratulations on this award. It's awesome to be here with you.